Excellent. Thank you so much for joining us. And to be honest, we are so grateful that you are here. We would have been grateful even without the excitement. So it's great to see you now in our virtual room. Greetings to all of you from the Nanovec Institute here from the University of Notre Dame. Welcome to our second keynote of our conference on the trauma of communism. As you know, the conference is part of our Catholic Universities Partnership, where the Nanovec Institute works closely with university partners from Central and Eastern Europe. Our conference seeks to explore personal accounts of the experience of communism, of the experience of the trauma of communism, and of the ways to respond to the traumatizing dynamics. We are honored to, if I may say so, finally, welcome Tomasz Alik as a distinguished guest to our conference. Monsignor Alik is a Czech Roman Catholic priest, a philosopher, a theologian. He is a professor at the Charles University in Prague and has had a global impact as a spiritual leader and leading intellectual. He has been a visiting professor in Oxford, Cambridge, and Harvard, and has also been here at Notre Dame with the Institute of Advanced Studies, most recently as Director's Fellow in 2017-2018. Professor Alik has published numerous books that have been translated in close to 20 languages, providing a spiritual diagnosis of our times. His book, I Want You to Be, from 2016, published by the University of Notre Dame Press, received the Catholic Press Association Book Award for Theology in 2017. His book, Patience with God, received the prize for the best European theological book for 2009-2010 by the decision of the European Society for Catholic Theology. Professor Alik has received numerous international prizes and awards, including the Cardinal Koenig Prize, the Romano Guardini Prize, and in 2014, the Templeton Prize. We are delighted to have you with us. You have so much to say about the trauma of communism, since you have been an active member of religious and cultural dissent during the communist era. Professor Alik was secretly ordained as a Catholic priest and was active in the underground church. The keynote address that we are about to listen to is entitled The Church's Experience of Communism and Post-Communism in the Heart of Europe. Professor Alik will talk for about 40 minutes and we will not shorten that. So please allow us to go a little bit over time according to the schedule. We will have a few minutes probably for Q&A. Dear audience, please put your questions or comments into the chat. Professor Alik, we are so grateful that you are with us. Please, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the invitation. Thank you for the introduction. Greetings from Prague. I had a story about Indians who were being removed by colonists from their original settlements and brought to new ones. Before the end of the trip, the Indians asked for a break, explaining our bodies might be almost at the end of the trip, but our souls are still in those old homes. We have to wait for our souls. For the young generation in our countries, communism is a thing of distant past. They are Europeans and citizens of the West, but the souls of the older generation are to some extent still trapped in this past and carry many wounds. Marxism had been dead in communist countries long before the fall of communism. It was the official ideology, but in reality, almost no one had believed in it for many years, not even the vast majority of the communist officials. As a rule, they were simply cynical apparatchiks. There were far less convinced Marxists in the East than in the West. What kept communism in power for so long was not belief in an ideology, but instead an unwritten pact between the rulers and the ruled. So long as citizens passively conformed and did not demand their rights and freedoms, the regime guaranteed them a certain level of social security and freed them from the burden of decision making. It cultivated a human type that a Russian writer Zinoviev, and after him the Polish philosopher Father Tischner, called Homo Sovieticus, someone lacking initiative, creativity, and responsibility. I'm convinced that the main role in the collapse of the communist system was played by the globalization process. When a free market of goods and ideas was created, the communist system, with their state planet economies and censorship of culture and ideas, were soon stifled in the wind of competition. The unwritten pact between the communist rulers and the citizens lost its material and psychological foundations. The post-communist era brought a bitter realization. To change political and economic structures is not enough, because the Homo Sovieticus is not able to hold his ground in a free society. To come to terms with the communist past, this implies pointing clearly to the anthropological roots of totalitarianism, to those forms of behavior and character traits that enabled the totalitarian regime to survive for so long. To restore democracy meant overcoming the Soviet man in us. The persuasion that the mere existence of a free market and the privatization of property will give life to a new, better human type is as naive as was the Marxist expectation that this could be reached by the collectivization and socialization. Man is simply not primarily determined by economic factors of social development, as Marx quotes, or as it is believed of some theoreticians of upside-down Marxism, the post-communist market fundamentalist, like the Václav Klaus in our country. At the beginning of the 1990s, essentially two groups of people took power. The former dissidents, active opponents of communism, were very visible, such as Václav Havel and Lech Walesa. But there was another less visible group who held on to power longer, namely part of the former communist elites, who alone possess the capital of money, contacts, and information. Thus, the last communist became the first capitalist. Those elites, first of all, took control of the business sector and from there started to exert their influence in politics. First in Russia, and then in a number of past communist countries, gangs of oligarchs with no moral scruples at all formed the economic and hence also the political elites. They were most successful where there had been a failure to establish the rule of law and where civil society was weak. With the fall of the Soviet Empire, the countries of Central and Eastern Europe won back their independence, and with it came an increased sense of national identity and pride. However, the logic of globalization now oblige these same countries to increasingly respect decisions of supranational bodies in the economic and political fields alike. Attempts to resurrect a free culture and spiritual life of their own face competitive pressures from the local television, which for commercial reasons opts mostly for the cheapest product of the stupid American entertainment industry. After the collapse of the communist regimes, a considerable section of society had great expectation of the church and churches, and it was disappointed. Also, a certain degree of persecution is beneficial to the church. Long term, severe persecution, and particularly isolation from the evolution of theological thinking, is damaging to it. Churches have rapidly lost their aura of martyred institutions and have become a favorite whipping boy of the media. No wonder, then, that many believers are among those who suffer in present post-communist society from agoraphobia, to borrow the term from psychopathology, namely an abnormal fear of open spaces, or literally, fear of the market. After the collapse of communism, two types of missionaries soon appeared in the Czech Republic. The first consisted of fundamentalist evangelical Christians from the United States, brandishing a Bible in one hand and a hamburger in the other, who roared it in stadiums in the expectation of mass conversion. The Czech natural skepticism could scarcely provide fertile soil for that kind of Christianity. The second type were conservative Catholics from the West who were convinced that the artificially isolated church was a Snow White, that was fortunate enough to have slept for several decades, including during the period of Vatican II reforms, and they were now arriving like Prince Charming to awaken the church in all its pre-modern beauty and gain a welcome ally against liberal theology in the Church of the Martyrs. It was a very dangerous temptation. In Czechoslovakia, and I think in some other countries under communist rule as well, the reforms of the Council of Vatican II were received very superficially and formally because most priests had not had the opportunity to study the theology from which the council grew. Without knowing this intellectual context, they could hardly understand the meaning of the council. Paradoxically, however, those who understood the council message best were those who had been completely isolated for many years. It was they who had the experience of practical ecumenism from communist prisons. Some of them accepted a time of persecution as a time of purification and penance for the church's earlier triumphalism. In prison, they dreamed of a church that was ecumenical, poor, serving, the church as spoken of in the Pact of the Catacombs, in the documents of the Council, and now Pope Francis. During the Prague Spring of 68, I met a number of those outstanding priests who had only recently returned after many years in prison and labor camps. They became my teachers of faith. On the other side, many Christians subconsciously expected that the fall of communism would herald a return to the situation they knew before World War II. However, instead of the traditional pre-modern situation, a complex post-modern vista has opened up. Traditional society, in which the church virtually merged with the prevailing culture, and subsequent totalitarian state with its militantly atheistic ideology represented quite distinct situation for religious institutions and called for distinct strategies. Pluralistic democracy and the postmodern culture climate presents a third type, which requires the church to redefine once more its social role and evolve a new and quite distinct strategy. Some Christians found themselves unable to live without an enemy. And after the collapse of the communism, they looked for a new one, and Western liberalism started to fulfill that role in their eyes. Certain churches adopted vis-a-vis the liberal environment the strategy of hostility and circle defense that they had learned from their confrontations with the communist regimes. As a result, the churches alienated large group of those who had sympathized with them at the time of communism's collapse and who had also invested great hopes in them on the threshold of democratic renewal. In the Czech Republic, the numbers of people identified with the churches has fallen dramatically year by year. There is a widening gulf between the world of traditional religions and the secular world of the West. One of the paradoxes of the globalism is the fact that the efforts to prevent any religion or religious community from dominating the shared world so that public space remains strictly secular are having the effect of turning secularism itself into something sacred. I understand the fear of some Christian circles that after the fall of state-enforced atheism in the East, the state-imposed secularism of the West might win. In spite of this, I think it is very important that these fears should not rush Christians into the fundamentalist camp. Very dangerous is the abuse of religious emotions and the phraseology by populists and nationalists. In certain Christian circles in the post-communist world, traditionalism and fundamentalism, the yearning for simple answers to complex questions has flourished. We see this today, in particular in the efforts of Viktor Orban's regime in Hungary to replace democracy with an authoritarian state, in his terminology, illiberal democracy, and to make Hungary a Trojan horse for Russian and Chinese interests in the European Union. The alliance between the populist government of Jaroslav Kaczynski and some conservative bishops has damaged Christianity in Poland more in 2 years than the communist regime did in a half a century. The fastest process of secularization and the loss of trust of young generation in the church is taking place in Poland today. I saw in Warsaw crowds of people with cross in their hands, screaming anti-Semitic slogans and singing, "We want God." What kind of God do they want? I'm afraid that such a God has nothing to do with what Jesus called his own and our common Father. It reminds me of the cry of evangelical fanatics in the Bible Belt of the US, "Jesus Christ is my savior, Donald Trump is my president." the pandemic of populism and nationalism, the misuse of Christian rhetoric to advance lost culture wars is a very dangerous phenomenon, not only in the post-communist world. We should make the world to think again. I myself have found faith amidst people who, in spite of the pressure of militant atheist dictatorship, have not become people with closed minds. At a time when communists try to establish the hardest variant of closed society in my country and attempt to kill God in people's minds was part of the attempt at abolishing the freedom of political, economic, and cultural life, at least some Christians realize that it is necessary to leave the ghetto mentality behind and accept as their natural allies all those who search for truth and love freedom. During the communist period, in common with many Christians, I discovered that faith gives us the strength to stand the test in the difficult circumstances of persecution. For many Christians who stood the test during the period of persecution, it is hard to stand the test at this time of freedom. They grew too used a time when the world was black and white, when it was clear who was with us and who wasn't, and where the boundary between good and evil was situated. They find it even more damaging and complicated to live in freedom that opens up a many huge palette of opportunity and requires one to make choices over and over again. I'm firmly convinced, however, that a real and healthy faith is the courage to be free. It gives us strength to accept freedom with all its risks. I believe that God summoned us to freedom, even so he knew all the risks entailed. Let me add two notes, a kind of short case studies on the situation in the Czech Republic. In Czechoslovakia, the persecution of the church become much more intense than in any of the surrounding countries of the so-called socialist camp. It would seem that the Stalinists have chosen our country as a soil to experiment with the total atheization of society. In a sense, they have favorable conditions for the experiment. The country's dramatic religious history, the burning at the stake of Jan Hus at the Council of Constance 1415, the five crusades against the heretical Czechs, the violent recotarization of Bohemia in the 17th century, and the Catholic Church enlightenment with the Habsburg monarchy, all left their trace. Whereas the Poles regarded the Catholic Church as a main pillar of their Polish national identity in opposition to Orthodox Russia and Protestant Germany, modern Czech nationalism, an ideology created to fight for the emancipation of the Czech lands from Vienna, in other words, from Austro-Catholicism and Rome, regarded Czech identity as scarcely compatible with Roman Catholic identity. After the fall of Austrian monarchy, a delegation representing considerable part of the Czech Catholic clergy demanded reformist changes from Rome, including the democratization of the church, the introduction of the national language into the liturgy, the rehabilitation of Jan Hus, and voluntary celibacy. Rome's response was resolute and took the form of a single war, numquam, never. Most of the reform-minded clergy accepted it with the cleansed teeth, but a part of clergy and laity left the Catholic Church at that time. Czech lands, in contrast to agrarian Slovakia, could boast advanced industrialization and a high level of general education already in the 19th and in the beginning of the 20th century. The traditional rural communities, agrar communities, a biosphere of a popular church and piety, retreated in the face of modern urban culture. It was a good social condition for secularization. The Czech lands thus went through the period of soft cultural secularization before World War II, then a period of hard secularization during the communist regime, and again another wave of soft secularization after reintegration into the pluralistic culture of the West. The Czech Republic is now regarded, along with the areas of the former GDR, East Germany, as one of the most atheistic regions of Europe, if not the whole world. But the fact that the vast majority of Czech society does not identify with churches does not mean that it is an atheistic society. There are even fewer convinced atheists than traditional Christians. Most Czech nonnas, non-identified with churches, are a diverse community of agnostics, apatheists, fans of alternative spiritualities, and spiritual seekers. Many people say, I believe in my own God. I don't go in the church, but I know there is something above us. I often say that somethingism is the most widespread religion among the contemporary Czechs. For me, as a theologian and a Czech Catholic priest, the hermeneutics of many forms of somethingism is a pastoral duty. Second note, let me very briefly recount my personal experience. I dictated in my autobiography, From the Underground Church to Freedom, published by Notre Dame University Press in 219. I was born 1948, in the year when the communists came to power in our country. I grew up in a secular intellectual family in Prague without a religious upbringing at a time when religion was completely banished from public life. My interest in religion was sparked by religious art, philosophy, and literature. The spring of 1968 was the spring of my life, the spring of my faith, and a new spring of the church in the wake of the Second Vatican Council. The occupation of Czechoslovakia by the five armies of the Warsaw Pact in August 68, ushered in another 20 years of communist persecution, which was not as brutal as under Stalinism in the 50s, but more sophisticated. In January 1969, I organized a requiem for Jan Palach, a student of our faculty, who set himself on fire to encourage opposition to the occupiers. His total self-sacrifice contributed to my decision to join dissent and become an underground priest. In those days, there was only one seminary for priests in the Czech lands, and it was totally under the control of communist state. only candidates who had no previous academic education could enter the seminary. I had already graduated in sociology, philosophy, and psychology from Charles University. So there was no path to take. I had to seek another route. In early 1970, I found my way to one of the underground church groups. The underground church was not a coordinated network with a single organizing structure, but rather a whole number of groups which worked autonomously and whose members knew only a few people outside of their own particular group. We did not curious about each other details because we knew that at future interrogations, they would not be able to beat out of us information we didn't have. There were essentially three sort of priests in the underground. One part considered of those priests who had been publicly ordained, but whom the state, the regime, had subsequently banished from their public ministry, so that they were obliged to work in a civilian jobs, just as night porters, lavatory cleaners, or boiler operators. They pursued their pastoral activity only clandestinely. They included, for instance, my friend Miroslav Vlk, the future Archbishop of Prague and Cardinal, who was employed as a window cleaner. But the actual core of the hidden church were those who had never received a state permission because they had been ordained secretly. They were ordained abroad, either in the GDR, East Germany, or Poland, or exceptionally, around the year 68, in the West. They were mostly members of religious orders, especially all male religious orders were forced into illegality. In a single April night in the 1950, all the monasteries and convents were invited by the police, and all members of orders were transported to a number of locations from where many were transferred to forced labor units or punishment detentions of the army, and some were put on trial and sentenced to lengthy penal servitude in prison or in the uranium mines. The third part of the underground priests were those who had been ordained by the secretly ordained Czech or Slovak bishops. The genesis of that branch of clandestine church dated back to before the communist putsch. Pius XII anticipated communist expansion to the other countries of Eastern and Central Europe and therefore adopted a number of preparatory measures. The measures included instruction to each of the bishops in Czechoslovakia to ordain an auxiliary bishop to serve in the event of their being imprisoned, sent to concentration camp, or executed. It now appears that Pius XII expected that period of repression would be exceptionally harsh, which he, while encourage priests to accept martyrdom, but of short duration. He did not believe that the victory of communism would be long-lasting or indeed permanent, which is also why he opposed any compromise with communists. Some of the measures taken by the Vatican just prior to the 1950s were unsuccessful, however. The names of secretly ordained bishops were soon discovered, and they were imprisoned often even before the sitting bishops, were forced out of their residences and ceased to perform their duties. Later, during the pontificates of John 23rd, and particularly of Paul the VI, the Vatican authorities concluded that it was necessary to resist the hardline approach to communist regimes, which had not achieved the anticipated results, and that a new strategy should be formulated chiefly in coordination with those who had most experience of the actual situation in those countries, in other words, the representative of the churches under communist rule. However, those who were able to speak officially on behalf of Czechoslovak Catholics, namely the vicars capitular, who acted as a would-be administrator of dioceses from the long-abandoned episcopal residences, were puppets of the communist regime and mouthpieces of their propaganda. The priests who supported the regime-sponsored peace movement of Catholic clergy were obedient tools of the Pax Sovietica. Seemingly influenced by global movement towards détente in the 1960s and the anticipated gradual liberalization of the Soviet bloc, the Holy See replaced its hardline Cold War tactics with a much more accommodating Ostpolitik, convinced and headed for many years by Cardinal Casaroli. In some countries, however, particularly Hungary, that policy of compromise and small steps caused the church long-term damage by undermining its moral credibility. Fortunately, the Czechoslovak communist regime almost throughout its existence, apart from a brief period during the Prague Spring, was so stubborn in its hostility toward the church that not even Casaroli's approach led to any compromises that might have been things slightly easier for the church, but would have gravely compromised in its moral terms. It seems that before they were arrested, some of the secretly ordained bishops of the first wave managed to ordain father bishops to replace them, but there was no time or opportunity to ordain bishops on the basis of pontifical appointment. However, in this matter, the canon law is inflexible. Here we enter the labyrinth of conjecture regarding matters that still remain painfully unresolved, not only in Bohemia, Moravian Slovakia, but also in China and other places where the church has found itself in extreme situations. That was the beginning of the genealogy of one part of the clandestine church, which would later achieve fame, particularly because of the activity of the Moravian clandestine bishop Felix Davidek. Felix Davidek ordained many priests, both celibate and married men. They accepted ordination in the conviction that Felix Davidek and his people had Rome's permission in our exceptional situation to ordain Roman Catholics in Eastern Rite, in which throughout its history, it has been possible for married men to be ordained priests. Davidek ordained at least two women as Catholic priests. He justified it on the ground of his expectation that in the 70s there would be similar persecution of the church as in the 50s, and that women, Christians, would find themselves in prison or concentration camps where there would be a need for a service of a priest. That was one of the reasons divisions and splits started to occur among the priests and bishops in his koinotes community. Davidek himself did not live to see the events of 1989. Back to my life story, very shortly. When I had completed roughly 5 years of spiritual training and theological study in the clandestinity, I was secretly ordained deacon by Bishop Auferbeck in the private chapel, in his private chapel in Erfurt in East Germany, 1977. At the same place, I was ordained priest on October 21st, 78. It was on the eve of the inauguration of a new Pope, John Paul II. Very early next morning, I celebrated my first Mass in the small chapel of the nuns, and after the Mass, the bishop and I went to watch to a live broadcast of the Pope's intronization on West German television and hear his first homily on the St. Peter's Square, which culminated with the words, "Do not be afraid." I realized that I must have been the first priest to have been ordained during this pontificate and wonder whether I would ever have the opportunity to meet him in person and share that fact with him. But over 11 years would pass before it happened. The community of priests that I belonged to operate cautiously, covertly, and on the basis of strict secrecy, and this provided to be a prudent strategy. We never regarded ourselves as a some special church alongside or even against the church that officially functioned in Czechoslovakia. We concentrated on what was officially forbidden: spiritual exercises, study groups, and attempts at a kind of categorical pastoral activity, particularly in areas familiar to us and which were strictly prohibited by the communists, such as work with students and young intellectuals. We wanted to prevent the church being reduced to the bare minimum of activity permitted by the atheist regime, essentially the liturgy and the repair of church buildings, which many members of the laity and even the clergy were being to become accustomed to. Later, I chiefly prepared candidates for the priesthood, assisting their studies and spiritual training, and giving them exercises prior to their ordination. In some cases, I was witness to their secret ordination, mostly in Berlin, in the private chapel of Cardinal Meissner, or at night in the crypt of St. Hedwig Cathedral. Our association did not consider the union of priesthood with the civil vocation and life in the secular environment as a temporary provision forced by political circumstances, but as a very important approach that will also be necessary in the future, even if the church is granted full freedom. We felt a kinship with the Mission de France movement and the work of priest workers, some of whom we met during the Prague Spring, and some of whom we met secretly during holidays in Hungary. We considered the classical territorial network of parishes to be outmoded. Josef Zvěřina, the great theologian of the underground church, wrote a text entitled A Third Way, in which he sought to defend this form of priesthood linked with civilian occupation as a legitimate model alongside those of parish priests and priests in the monastic orders. we gave thought to a theology and spirituality for this part of ministry. The Charter 77 movement, the election of the Polish Pope, the emergence of the Solidarity Trade Union movement in Poland, and the change of direction in Western foreign policy under Reagan and Thatcher, and finally Gorbachev and his perestroika, this all indicated that the Soviet Empire was starting to be shaken to its foundations. The Czechoslovak communist regime still showed no sign of reform, however. Sometimes around 1983, Father Otto Mader, who tried to coordinate and manage the various underground activities of the church, invited me to be a member of the advisory center, which would prepare a new direction within the church in response to newly emerging needs. The group included representatives of the main male orders working clandestinely, as well as a few key priests representing individual dioceses, thus constitute an important point of contact between the above ground and underground church structures. Together with some open-minded theologians, the editors of the most influential Samizdat periodicals, and representatives of church movements and other activities, active Catholic circles. Its first job would be to map out the over-situation, to overcome fragmentization, and in the absence of the bishop's conference, to direct the life of the church. This group became brain trust of the old Cardinal František Tomášek. This Archbishop of Prague was very cautious for many years, but at the end of his long life, under the influence of John Paul II, and with the help of this group, he became an international known symbol of resistance against the communist regime. November 89, the canonization of Agnes of Bohemia took place in Rome. The authorities did make concession and decided to allow thousands of believers to travel to Rome, even including those who had been prevented from traveling to the West for years. To my surprise, I received permission. In Rome, I sent a letter to Monsignor Gibish, the secretary of the Holy Father, via Monsignor Škarvada, the bishop for Czechs in exile, who worked at the Secretary of State in Vatican, requesting an audience and setting out the matters I would like to submit to the Pope. 2 days later, I received a letter that the Holy Father had invited Bishop Škarvada and me to a private dinner on November the 7th. It was the eve of the fall of Berlin Wall, and the television already has covered the demonstration in East Germany. The Pope declared, "This is the end of communism." And not just in East Germany. Get ready, you too will soon be free. I permitted myself to say that the papal infallibility did not extend to such things and voiced the skeptical view that there might be a few years of Gorbachev-style perestroika. But the Pope repeated once more that the communism would soon collapse and our church should prepare itself for that movement. It happens in 10 days. On November the 20th, I flew home to Prague with Cardinal Tomášek. At the Prague airport, the Cardinal was welcomed by the Italian ambassador with the words, "Eminence, here is the revolution here." In the period immediately following November 89, I truly lived through the period as in a feverish dream. Everything merged together in quick succession. I was already over 40 when a completely new chapter of my life opened. I spent 11 years in service of the underground church and in the milieu of culture and political dissent. Not even my mother, with whom I lived, was allowed to know that I was a priest. Now I could work publicly in the church and in academia, as well as take part in founding a number of initiatives and institutions within the church, the university, and political life. I worked closely with the leading representative of church and state for many years. I was close to President Václav Havel. On January 25th, 1990, I celebrated my first public mass. In February, I started teaching at the Faculty of Theology and became the rector of St. Saviour Church, where I later founded the first academic parish in our country. Also in February, I received an invitation from Pope John Paul II, come to the Vatican and prepare his first trip to Czechoslovakia, his first trip to the post-communist world. I spent more than a month in the Vatican and met the Pope almost daily. Then the Pope appointed me an advisor to Pontifical Council for Dialogue with Unbelievers, and a new established Czech Bishops' Conference elected me its first General Secretary. In December, I was elected the President of the Czech Christian Academy. Because of my long-term study of theology, was unofficial during the communist era. In 1990 and 1992, I passed the necessary exams at the Pontifical Lateran University in Rome and at the Pontifical Theological Faculty in Wroclaw and became a doctor of theology. For almost two decades, I was not allowed to travel anywhere outside the communist bloc. Over the next 20 years, I visited every continent on the planet, including the Antarctic. After being excluded from academia for 20 years, I had the opportunity to lecture at the university in Europe, in the USA, Latin America, Asia, Africa, and Australia. Later, I received an honorary doctorate in theology from the University of Erfurt and Oxford University. Every year, after my 50th birthday, I traveled to a contemplative monastery in Rhineland and spent 4 or 5 weeks there on my own in silence in a hermitage. And all my books came into being there. In my 60th year, my book started to be translated into 20 languages. During the last 32 years, I baptized in our parish, after 2 years catechumenate, almost 3,000 adults. According to Pope Francis, the great prophet of our time, the church should serve as a field hospital in today's world. I think this metaphor needs to be further developed. The churches, as well the universities and many civil society communities and initiatives, should jointly address the diagnosis, prevention, therapy, and recovery of infectious disease of our civilization, especially populism that make people silly and cruel. We should help the world to think again. It looks as if global Christianity stands on the threshold of another of its historical metamorphosis. Are we growing to wage culture wars that will lead to a clash of civilizations? Or are we going to build Civitas Ecumenica in the spirit of the encyclical Fratelli Tutti? I hope that the critical reflection of experience of Christians in the struggle for freedom may be useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Halik. Thank you so much. I do really not want to keep you much longer. I know that we are already 11 minutes over our planned schedule, also because of our technological problem we had. Huh? Yes? So I think I will just admit two questions, if you're okay with that, Professor Halyk. Just two questions. The first question is on gratitude. Yesterday, we recalled 1 Thessalonians 5:18, give thanks in all circumstances. When after decades, looking back to communism, its atrocities, its victims, etc., the fate of the church in that brutal, inhumane system, in what would you find reason to give thanks to God, our Almighty Father? You personally, what are you thankful for to the Lord when thinking about that red period of the history of humanity and of the church and of your own personal life history?
That's good question. I think it was a great gift from God, and I'm very, very thankful to God that I got this experience, because it was an opportunity to mature, to the opportunity to go deeper, the opportunity to ask new questions. And I think only in the critical situation, in the crisis are always kairos. Are the opportunity to go deeper, to find something more. The persecution and the suffering lead not automatically to more maturity. For many people were broken or damaged or scars by situation. But I think it's always an opportunity to find a new ways. And for example, when I was priest and I've got the civil profession, I was not so on distance in the parish house. I lived with other people, and I shared the experience of them. So I think now my pastoral successes or fruits are the fruit of this experience. So that I know the problems of people, that I know the language of people. I was not so isolated. And this disease of clericalism, which is so damaging, and Pope Francis speaks about it, I think it was some prevention of this clericalism.
Thank you. Thank you. And a last question. I apologize to our audience that we have to respect busy schedules and cannot accommodate more. The last question is this. Professor Halyk, how would you define the concept of persecution of Christians nowadays? What could qualify as persecution beside the situation where the profession of faith would be life-threatening? In Ukraine, this is where the question comes from, during late Soviet time, open Christians would not be sentenced to prison, but they could lose their job and get marginalized in social life. Nowadays, in the US Christian hospitals, US Christian hospitals could be shut down and people lose their jobs if they reject performing performing abortions on demand, or a similar situation with Christian adoption services. Would it qualify as harassment, if not yet persecution?
Not a persecution. I think they are quite very different things, and we should not to confuse it. So the direct persecution by the totalitarian state or the post-totalitarian state, like is the Belarus today. But the confrontation with the secularism is something else, and there must be a different strategy. We must come to the dialogue, not just the culture war. The culture war, it's nonsense. So when some people from the West told me, yes, it is the same, the persecution of the Christians in the communist time and the troubles the Christians have in the secular societies, I always quote a nice Jewish joke that on the synagogue, there was written, if you enter without a hat, it is the same like to commit adultery. And the next day, somebody wrote there, I exercise both, but it is not to compare. I think I exercise both the communist persecutions and some confrontations with the very psycho-liberal people, but it is not to compare. And I think we must, it will be very dangerous if we take such a fundamentalist position. I think we must come into a dialogue with such of people. Somewhere it is perhaps difficult, but in our country, I think I always try to create on our Christian Academy a place, a platform for a dialogue also with these secular intellectuals. And if we speak face to face, so many prejudices are over.
Thank you so much, Professor Halyk. We don't want to keep you any longer. I just want to thank you for your inspiring lecture and of course also for the testimony of your life. You mentioned the danger of fundamentalism and that we should be careful with that. I think you also suggested there's a role for universities and education in being sensitive to fundamentalism, which brings me to the announcement that tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock Eastern US time, we will have our third keynote for our conference by Jim McAdams on Catholic universities, communism, and the legacies of intergenerational trauma. So join us tomorrow at 8 o'clock Eastern US time for our third keynote. For today, I thank Professor Halyk very much for your time, your flexibility, the inspiration. Thank you to the audience for bearing with us. We are a little bit over time. Have a lovely evening and a wonderful day. Thank you.
I thank you also for this opportunity. And I thank the Notre Dame University for this initiative. And I have the best experience with the Notre Dame University. I think it is exactly the place in between the two extremes, some clericalism and liberalism, and some very, very, very healthy Christianity. So I was very happy there, and God bless you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Rosalie. Come again to Notre Dame.